Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. However you're watching, wherever you're watching, however you listen, wherever you listen, it's the Bet Online Salute Detroit podcast, and the tripod is back. The beers are in full effect. Madman is coming. We're slowly convincing him. Even the comments, Madman, are saying, just grow it. Just grow it. You can get one of those Norelcos and, like, trim it, bro. Like, just join the club. It's okay. The stage you're in right now, you just got to get through this stage, and you'll be all right. Trust me. Just grow it. We even have Preston on trying to convince him to get the beard. But like I said, it's the Bet Online Salute Detroit podcast. We have the tripod. It's a good day. The shadows are creeping over the mountains of fall. One of the best seasons in the history of man is coming, and it's called football. We're about 14 days out from the actually, there's a kickoff this weekend, I believe. I could be wrong.
Yeah.
So we got some football coming. It's coming, folks. And the thing about football, like Jamal always says, before you know it, we'll be opening up gifts and the season will be over and we'll be searching for shows. So neither here nor there, that said, let me kick it off to Madman. Madman, how are you doing today?
Doing well, guys. Great to see you as always. And the other big sort of deadline event, major circumstance upon us is it's Salute Detroit on Friday evening. So we're only a few days Detroit, away yep. from that. So it really... Salute Detroit always feels like the beginning of the season to me. You know, after that event, you're ready to go. You never know what you're going to get, you know. A lit up Steve Sarkisian, you know, some hype for the season. You know, it's always a good time. So we know we're close to the season when this is Salute Detroit week. So very excited and always excited to be here with you guys.
Ryan, how are you doing?
Yeah, good. It's funny. A buddy texted me just today, like, hey, are you going to Salute Detroit? And automatic in my head, I'm like, yeah, we're recording tonight. Like, I don't know. Like, we record Mondays and Thursdays. It didn't register since the show's called to Detroit. But yeah, it's a good week football. Yeah, it's what Florida State and Georgia Tech and Dublin randomly like is that. This Saturday. Yeah. I Notre Dame so. Always opens in Dublin. So it's kind of a random Florida State and Georgia Tech. But anyway, football's back. And yeah, good seeing you gentlemen and excited for sure.
So fun fact, Ryan, I got the name of the show from that event. That's why I wanted to name it.
I mean, yeah, obviously. Yeah.
But I will tell you also another good story. At work, there's somebody who was going to Salute Detroit, big SC fan, and they lied and said it was a scrimmage. And I'm like, a game. They said it was a game. I'm like, a game? Like, why is this person missing work to go watch a scrimmage? It makes no sense. And then he was like, well, you meet the players and everything too. I said, are you talking about Salute Detroit? He was like, yeah, it's Salute Detroit. I said, there's no scrimmage for Salute Detroit. That's just the big fireworks show. It's the end of camp. And he was like, bro, you're going to kill the whole thing for me. I'm like, it's pointless. He's like, well, I really want to go. I ruined this whole thing. I felt so bad about it. Like, after I thought about it, I'm like, I don't remember what you said, Jamal. Like, there's a different connection to it. So I was like, I felt really bad about it. But I'm like, it's just Salute Detroit. Like, for me, it's like, I hate a Salute Detroit, to be honest with you, because it's pointless. Like, it's a fan thing. Like, we did nothing but eat and wait to walk on the stage and the fireworks show and then went home. Like, so the only good thing about Salute Detroit is it's the end of camp. That's the only thing that marks the end of camp. Speaking of the end of camp, major announcement today in the headlines. Twitter world's been blowing up for, the past 2 hours? I guess I wasn't in the loop. I wasn't informed. I'm not woke. Or maybe I'm just really, I'm just a realist and realize that it wasn't really a battle. But there was a quarterback battle. And Miller Moss has won the starting quarterback spot. No surprise. I don't see why he wouldn't win it. I get why Lincoln Riley did it, but it's been announced today. Lincoln Riley announced today that Miller Moss is officially the starting quarterback. The long-awaited junior quarterback finally gets his shot to go, be at the helms, open it up against LSU in Vegas. I'm excited to see what happens. The most thing I'm excited about this happening, before I get you guys' opinion on this, is we're going to see a whole bunch of shandies this fall. I know it's a summer drink in Boston, but that Miller Lemon connection is going to be amazing up the scene for multiple touchdowns, and we're going to get this season kicked off. Ryan, what do you think about the big announcement about Miller Moss being the starting quarterback for the University of Southern California?
Yeah, we all knew it was coming, like you said, how much of a competition. I think it was legit competition. Like, obviously, when you're a coach, you want to instill in your guys that they're not just given anything. Like, you got to earn everything. And Miller Moss has obviously had to earn everything his whole way in his college career. And Jaden Maeva transferred SC for a reason. Part of that is development, but, you know, he didn't want to come here and sit for a year. He wanted to compete to start right away. So I think it was a legit open competition, but I think it was clear from the beginning it was Miller Moss's job to lose, which we knew after the Holiday Bowl, we knew after the Spring Bowl or Spring Game, we knew after Big Ten Media Day when he was one of the captains and guys representing the program. How funny would that have looked, right? Like, he represented the team and then Jaden Maeva's the starting quarterback. So we all knew this was kind of coming, but I think it's good that now, still a week left of camp and then a full week before the game, that it's done. There's no questions because, you know, every day media is there. They're asking, you know, I was there on Thursday and asked Coach Heward, and he had to answer and say, oh, it's up to Lincoln. Like, it's up to him. So now it's done. Put it to bed. You know, Miller Moss is the guy, and it's the way it should be. And I think Jaden Maeva showed a lot of good things, and they're really excited about him. As I've said, I do personally, this is no intel, it's just my, I do believe there'll be some packages. Well, they'll use Maeva. I just think he has too much talent to not do anything all season long. But this is Miller Moss's team, as it should be. And it's exciting that we can now just move forward and talk about him truly being the guy in terms of official, because now it's officially announced. So yeah, hats off. Congrats to Miller Moss. Well-deserved.
Man, the mic is yours.
No, totally agree with Ryan. I mean, let's be honest. I think Miller Moss won this job last December at the Holiday Bowl, and it's basically been, you know, him essentially kind of lapping the field, and, you know, not just that for what he can do on the field, but I think he has, you know, undoubtedly shown that he's the emotional and spiritual leader of this team, the guy who's waited his turn, who truly wants to be a USC Trojan, kind of the pedigree, the lineage of his family. You know, being USC is in his blood. And I think that's that enthusiasm, that sort of vitality for the game and for the team is really going to show this year. So obviously very well deserved. It's what we expected. And I think part of the wrinkle this year, I think, is going to be if you just sort of look at the measurables and the frame and the skill set, you know, Maeva is sort of more of a quote-unquote Lincoln Riley guy of the last 6 or 7 years. Like, if you think about Caleb and you think about Jalen Hurts and you think about Kyler Murray and you think about Baker Mayfield, Maeva's skill set is actually closer to those guys than Miller Moss's skill set to those guys. And so I think what's going to be fascinating about this season is I think we're going to see a new dimension of the Lincoln Riley offense, because Miller Moss is kind of the outlier from this sort of lineage of quarterbacks that has made Lincoln Riley so famous and such a quarterback whisperer and such an offensive guru. So that's what I'm also so excited about, is just how the players not only gravitate towards Miller Moss from an emotional standpoint. Remember, everyone was screaming, we're a team now. We're a team now, back in the Holiday Bowl, to see that sort of translate over the course of a full 12-game regular season and hopefully beyond. But then also to see, you know, Lincoln Riley, the mad scientist in the lab, in the shop, saying, how does this offense look a little bit differently with a different archetype of quarterback? So for all of those reasons, it's going to be so exciting to watch the evolution of this team. And that journey begins, you know, a few days away, ironically enough, in Vegas against LSU. So very excited for the Miller Moss, you know, era, if you will, to officially begin with LSU.
By the way, I just want to let you guys know, at Trader Joe's, they have Venus flytraps, and my wife is playing with this plant. She's been playing with this plant for 2 hours. So if you see me looking, she's over here playing with a Venus flytrap. I'm sorry.
The way you opened that, I thought that we got a new sponsor in Trader Joe's. I was like, when did we get the new Trader Joe's sponsor? The way you opened, you know.
At Trader Joe's, you could buy a Venus flytrap, and they trap flies and they trap ants. So yeah. Like she went and bought some tweezers from the store, and she's getting the flies from outside in the windowsill and putting them in the fly trap and watching the fly trap close. She's like a 4-year-old right now. She's so excited about this thing. It's crazy.
Wow.
And,
nice.
And she keeps like jumping and getting excited every time the thing closes.
Sid from Toy Story, just like torturing these flies.
Anyway, sorry about that. So Jamal, I'm very upset with you because you stole everything why USC is probably going to go like 6-0, and everybody's going to be shocked because what Lincoln Riley is going to do with Miller Moss is nowhere on film, and it's going to take about 6 weeks to catch up, which is a very good thing because we're going to see the legit art of his pass game with Miller Moss at quarterback, right? We know what he could do with Maiava. We know what he could do with the RPO stuff. We know how he could get the ball out quick. What we saw at the Holiday Bowl was just a taste. There was still a lot of Caleb Williams offense at the Holiday Bowl, if that makes sense. Like, those are the plays. Like, this right now, it's going to be Lincoln Riley able to show his concepts as far as pass game and everything like that. This season right now for Miller Moss, and we'll talk about it more, but I'll leave him this cliffhanger. This season right now could either be his last year winning a Heisman Trophy or him coming back trying to be a second-round pick next year. That's the whole different of margins that could happen with Miller Moss just because of the school he plays for, who his coach is, and how much notoriety is on him right now. I never thought his job was in jeopardy, even though there are culture vultures out there saying, oh, Maiava looks so great and doing this and that. Yeah, he's more athletic than Miller Moss. He's going to run around more than Miller Moss. But a true artist at quarterback, this is what made Caleb such an artist. Go look at Caleb's rushing yards. I don't think it was nowhere close to 1,000. His goal was never to run the ball. Caleb always kept his eyes downfield, and he created people to get open. He wanted to throw the ball, kind of like Ben Roethlisberger. That's kind of why he's having the success he's having in preseason. Miller Moss is an old-school quarterback that's going to stand in the pocket, get hit in the mouth, and still get the pass off. This is going to be – this has the potential to be really, 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 really great. And I'll explain why in our next show, but – this is going to be this has a potential to be a really, really good season. So I'm happy for him. I'm happy he finally got it. I can't wait to see what happens. And let's move forward and let's, Miller Moss, you're our guy. You have the, you get the sword. You get to stand on the ladder. Fight on, buddy. Let's go. Jamal Ryan, you got anything else before we move on this?
And we're getting way ahead of ourselves, but we're still in August, so we can get ahead of ourselves. But what's so fun about college football and specifically playing quarterback for Lincoln Riley is we've seen quarterbacks that don't play for Lincoln Riley that in 1 year can skyrocket their future. I mean, Jaden Daniels just last year probably would have been a mid-round pick, ends up getting taken, you know, second overall. Look at Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow probably was undrafted and becomes one of the greatest college quarterbacks ever in 1 year, number one overall pick, and now a franchise QB in the NFL. So it's less far-fetched to say that in this season, Miller Moss could go from unknown outside of LA to a first-round pick. I mean, you said come back another year for a second-round pick. He could do it in 1 year, potentially. Now, again, we're getting way ahead of ourselves, but that's just the fun of what QBs can do in college and specifically what QBs can do in Lincoln Riley's system. So
I guess what I was saying was like, he could either be like, he could either really, really shine or he could just be an absolute bust.
Totally.
Right. And like the reason why is because he's going to throw the ball a lot and he's not going to throw the screen or he's not going to throw the shallow. He's going to throw the bang gate. He's going to throw the post. He's going to throw the seam. He's going to throw hole shots. He's going to throw crossing routes and the reverse scissor routes and switch routes. He's going to get read routes. Like, he's going to get a lot of different things compared to what Caleb got. You know, Caleb got shallow screens. He got the basic bang aid off of the smash route. He got a lot of basic route concepts. Miller Moss, and I'm not taking anything away from Caleb. We know how phenomenal athlete of Caleb is, but we're talking, Caleb is an athlete that plays quarterback. Miller Moss is a quarterback who gets an opportunity to be coached by Lincoln Riley. And I think this is the first time in his career he's actually had a legit quarterback, if that makes sense. And I think this is going to be something really special. And this is how special it could be. If Miller Moss decides to stay for 2 years, he could break a lot of records in 2 years. Like, a lot. and be really, really good. Like, so, like, Miller Moss could be so good. Like, if he has a season with Lincoln Riley, like, I think he can have, he'll be the most pro-ready quarterback coming into the draft right now. And he will have a tough decision to make. Do I want the NIL money or do I want the NFL money? That's what I mean in that.
Yeah, yeah. So in my opinion, and sorry, Jamal, you can go right after. I don't want to hog this. But in my opinion right now, I think this is kind of the only year for Miller Moss. And I don't mean that in a bad way. But if he dominates and is a Heisman hopeful, then I think he'll go to the NFL. If he has a subpar season, you got Jaden Maiva, who's going to be a junior, who has a lot of talent, and you got Julian Lewis coming in as a freshman. Like, I think they probably go with one of those guys. Like, who knows? There's so much time from now. But to me, this is Miller Moss's year. That's it. I think he'll be in the NFL or in the draft after this, hopefully in a good terms as a potential Heisman favorite. I don't see him right now in August. I don't see him coming back for another year and holding off those other two guys too.
Well, I will save it
for unless he's literally like the best quarterback in college and just wants to play one more year for a natty, then that's different. If he's like a Matt Leiner, if he's like a Matt Leiner, like I'm coming back for one more year, that's different. But if he's like a fringe guy, like they'll probably go with one of the other two, I think.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with Ryan. I think this is going to be his 1 year. I think even Leiner would tell you that it was probably a mistake to come back the additional year in terms of his sort of draft stock, right? He was sort of slated to be the third quarterback taken, right? After Luck and Smith, Rogers, and then it was going to be Leiner. You know, those were going to be the three that year. So I think if he does blow up just sort of with the window of opportunity, I totally agree. I think this is sort of the year for Miller Moss. And I think it's going to be really interesting about what version of quarterback are we going to get? Because to sort of the earlier point, this is now the first time that Lincoln Riley has a Mike Leach type of quarterback running his air raid. So does that mean we're going to get an NFL quality quarterback that's going to sort of blow up and be a first rounder, a second rounder? Or is he going to be like a Graham Harrell, you know, when he was at Texas Tech, or a guy that is throwing the ball 70 times a game, putting up a ton of stats, doing a lot of great things in college, but isn't really considered an NFL quarterback? So it's going to be sort of fascinating to see even what variation of performance and sort of prospect we're going to get this year. It can just go so many different ways. Obviously, the best case scenario is he blows up like the other four guys have blown up at OU and USC, and he's headed to be a first round, second round pick, and he's gone. Or, you know, is it that he's, you know, kind of a Graham Harrell couple games where he throws 65 passes, 70 passes? You know, is it that when you sort of take out the RPO and now all those plays become throws and they're not like scrambles, they're not keepers? Or is it that maybe, you know, he struggles a bit, and we hope that's certainly not the case. So it just, I think this can go any which way. And I think that's what makes this season so exciting. You know, last year we knew Caleb was going to be great. He was the reigning Heisman winner. So the window of interpretation, the window of analysis was a lot more narrow. Here, I mean, my God, it's so wide, right? And even sort of Vegas in terms of the win totals. I mean, some people are as low as 7.5 wins on USC. Other people believe this is 10, 11 wins. So it's very reflective in the projections. I mean, when you have a team that is swinging 5 wins, you know, in either direction, it really is kind of the Wild West this year. No one really knows until they step on the floor and on the field. And I think that's what's going to make this so exciting.
I was talking to Tim Prangley, our buddy, a few days ago, and he was saying, like, what do you think the win total is? You can't pick 8 or 9, 7 or 10. That's the big gap. Like, what's it going to be?
Totally.
If the defense can overcome some mistakes, which they were unable to last year, then there's a good chance. But we'll save that for the next show. Let's just leave it on the cliffhanger. They got a little bit about it. They got a little bit to talk about. But like I said, I'm excited for Miller Moss. I'm happy for the kid. He stuck it out and it came through for him. He has a chance to put his jersey in the Raptors next to Caleb, or he has a chance to be like JD. Everybody appreciates him, but everybody doesn't remember him.
Coach, you got to be careful with the initials JD in this day and age, you know. So,
all right, John David Booty, John David Booty. John David Booty.
Let me ask you. You're playing fast and loose with the letters JD, coach. Okay, yeah. let's take it easy over here.
John David Booty.
Let me ask you this before we move on. Who has a better season? Miller Moss or Jackson Dart? Former teammates, same recruiting class at SC. Obviously, Dart's at Ole Miss. And Dart's like a Heisman favorite.
Yeah, see, that's not fair because Jackson Dart played in this legit played in the.
Oh, it's not fair, but it's a podcast, so you can answer. Of course, it's not fair.
If I was biased, I'd say Miller Moss, but I mean, realistically, it'll probably be Jackson Dart. Well, yeah, go ahead, Jamal. Go ahead.
No, I think it's going to be Dart just because I think I really believe Ole Miss is one of the four best teams in America this year.
Yeah, I think they're, and he's literally started since being a freshman. I mean, after Keaton Slovis got hurt, he started at SC, so he's played a lot of football, and Moss has played one game.
Totally, so, exactly.
If Moss has a better season than Dart.
Oh no, that would be incredible. That would be absolutely incredible. Considering also, look at how Ole Miss was able to sort of clean up in recruiting, transfer portal. I mean, they're so stocked in the trenches right now on both sides of the ball. Really great backs, receivers. I know they lost Judkins to Ohio State, but they're pretty loaded there, and I think Ohio State, Oregon, Georgia, Ole Miss are probably the four best teams in the country right now.
Oregon will never be a best team. Oregon is just
don't get coach started, but yeah, Ole Miss like nice.
Oregon will never be the best team. They'll get you all excited, and then next thing you know, it's like never mind. I changed.
What will happen to coach if, God forbid, there's a situation where Oregon wins the Natty? What's going to happen to you, coach?
I'll never be able to live it down. I'll never be able to live it down.
Because you and our buddy Rusty are going to have to go into hiding.
Oh, man. Poor Rusty. You know, he's going to be in a – he's going to need some time in Fiji, you know, Bali. You know, there's going to be a few months there that's going to be required.
I can't even leave, and I'll have to deal with it, like, face-to-face, like, from my brother for at least the next 5 years. And probably till he dies. SC will win 6 more national championships, and he'll say, "Well, Oregon won that 1 year. Like, you guys haven't accomplished anything but uniforms and shoes. Like, let's be realistic. Like, fit them of college football. Let's move on. So, it came out today. Malachi Nelson, the quarterback that transferred from USC, said that he was supposed to be the guy after Caleb Williams. And then when they found out that Lincoln Riley was going out to recruit Will Howard, that's what solidified his decision to leave. It also came out today that he is not starting at Boise State. So coaches know. I'm going to try to say this the best way I can because he's still a kid, but there's still a lot of adults helping him make decisions. In this world, everything is competitive. Even when you don't think it's competitive, it's competitive. When you put a job application in, you're in a competition to be that best person to get the job. When you work at a job, you're in a competition with the rest of your fellow coworkers to be the top of the company. Everything is competitive in life. You want to be the richest person. You want to be the best at everything you could do. And it's not going to come easy. It requires hard work. It requires dedication. Nothing is just given to you. The fact that he based his logic off of that he was just supposed to be given the starting spot and somebody was coming in to compete with him and it made him leave. And then you go to Boise and you thought you were just going to be given the starting spot and you lose your starting spot to the quarterback at Boise. Tells me, realistically, you just weren't good enough. And I just had this conversation this past weekend. Everybody's going to get to college. There's kids in high school that are really, really good. And they get to college and they're just not good enough. There's people in the pros that are really, really good, and they get to the NFL, and they're just not good enough. That is the science of life. You peak at certain times in your life, and when you peak, and sometimes you don't get any better. I'll give you a great example. Allie Highsmith from when I was a kid was a linebacker for LSU, first team All-SEC. I believe he got SEC Defensive Player of the Year. Really, really good. I think it was the year Les Miles. I think it was the year they won the national championship. I don't know. Don't quote me on it. Seventh round draft pick, never came out to anything in the NFL. Does that mean that Ali Highsmith was a bad player? No, not at all. His peak was in college. Malachi Nelson's peak might have been in high school, and that's okay. Now he needs to learn how to flip the game and get a degree out of it, make as much money as he can, and set himself up for a future. I feel like he's about to become a situation with Keenan Slovis and the other quarterback from SC. They played against each other. One went to Pitt, one went to West Virginia. Help me out,
JT.
Guys.
JT
yeah.
Daniels, yeah.
Yeah, JT Daniels.
Like, not to be confused with JD, you know, JT Daniels. JT
Daniels, you're going to run all over the place trying to get a starting spot, and you're just not good enough. And it's okay. You're not going to be good at everything. You're not going to be the best at everything. But how much of a competitor are you going to be? How much are you going to stay and gut it out? If I'm a pro scout, what does that tell me about this kid? So if we go draft somebody, he's going to be ready to ask for a trade, and he's going to be ready to leave. And I have to emphasize this, and I want to make this point clear. It's not his fault. It's not his fault at all. He's getting bad information. He has too many people in his camp. He's trying to get to the NFL next year. Well, it's not going to happen next year, and somebody needs to tell him that reality, that next year is not his last year of college football. Like, you're not a starter. Are you going to go to another school and be a starter, and you're going to blow it up? You haven't taken any reps in a college football game. Like, you have to be realistic, and these people have to start telling these kids the truth. And he's not getting the truth from his camp, and his camp is sending him down a wrong path. He should still be at SC. He should be getting a degree from SC. He could get more money. Like, if it's about the money, you could work the money in. Figure it out. We're trying to fix the NIL. But the route that he's going is not a good route, and it's putting him in a worse situation. Now he's going to tank. Now he's a backup again. So where is he going to go next year? He's going to go to South Dakota State. Is he going to keep dropping lower and lower on the scale until he becomes a starter? Or are you going to lesser competition? Just stick it out. You might have developed and end up becoming a starter. You never know. You might have beat Mayava out. You never gave yourself that opportunity, and that's not his fault. Nobody told him to stick it out, and everybody's forcing him to leave to become the starter to get to the NFL. Hey, listen, Malachi Nelson, when you go to the NFL, you don't owe anybody shit. That is your money. You made that money. You worked hard for that money. You don't owe anybody anything. If you get there and enjoy the opportunity. Don't get there and try to figure out how you could pay everybody back, because that's how you end up in the situation you're in now, trying to make everybody happy. The only happiness that matters for you is your happiness. You need to figure out your happiness, and you need to figure out how to get to your happiness so you could play football and enjoy it, because this is how we get to players who are depressed, who go through mental illness and things like that, because of these issues. These are the root issues, bad camps and bad advice, and that's how he ended up here. I pass it on to you guys. I digress. Ryan, Jamal, you guys could take it. Whoever wants to go first.
Go ahead, Jamal. I'll go after you.
You know, Coach, really well said. I think that the bigger picture is, you know, A, to your point, needs I think some better guidance around, you know, life is competitive, to your point. You can't run away from competition. And now look at the situation that he's in. He was potentially, look, if Malachi stays, competes with Miller Moss, do you need to go get a Maeva, right? Like, it's sort of, you know, Malachi would be in the Maeva spot. Nothing wrong with being a backup to Miller Moss this year and then getting ready for sort of a competition. Maybe Julian Lewis is a little too young as a true freshman, you know, and you get your 1 year at SC and see where it takes you. And if it takes you all the way to the NFL, amazing. If it doesn't, you maybe get an opportunity to transfer. Let's, you know, and become the guy we were just talking about a few minutes earlier, like Jackson Dart, and now have a path to the NFL. So you can't kind of cheat the grind. You can't run from competition. So hopefully this is sort of a lesson learned in that regard. And then two, I think a huge point here is Lincoln Riley knows quarterbacks. And I think it's also a lesson to, you know, incoming recruits, where if you feel like you're not getting playing time or getting the requisite looks from a Lincoln Riley coaching staff or a Lincoln Riley offense, stick with it, because they know what they're talking about. if they're not giving you the keys to the kingdom, it probably means that you need to work on a few things, and then you'll have that opportunity. I think, Ryan, you're the one who said it a couple of weeks ago, right, when Miller Moss talked at Big Ten Media Day about a big turning point was in the Pac-12 championship game 2 years ago, where when Caleb got hurt, Lincoln Riley didn't really think to bring Miller Moss into the game. Felt like a Caleb Williams at 60 or 70% was still a better option than a Miller Moss at that time at 100% to be able to win the game. And that's tough to hear. That's hurtful to hear. But when you think about Miller Moss, he could have left at that point and said, look, I mean, I'm not, you know, they're not even looking at me as apples to apples. Like, I can't even beat out a guy, a 60% version of a guy. So I really have no shot here. I need to go somewhere else. He could have easily used that logic and gone somewhere else, but he stuck with it and he grinded it out. So I think, A, hopefully Malachi understands. And look, we wish all these kids well. These are 18 to 22-year-old kids. I mean, no one is coming at these kids. I mean, come on. This is entertainment. This is sports. We're just in the business of having great conversations about teams and schools that we love. We want to see all these kids succeed, all these kids live out their dreams. So hopefully for Malachi, this is a moment in time. And I think the one good thing is with the rules the way they are, where you can have unlimited transfers, he's still so early in his collegiate career. He can get this thing turned around. And this could be really that great lesson learned to kind of get him reframed moving forward. And then number two, like I said, my big takeaway is for the incoming recruits, you know, just because, to your point, Coach, you were great in high school, you were great in all-star camp, you know, Lincoln Riley knows quarterbacks, so he knows when you're ready, and he knows when you still have things to work on. So it just lends even more credibility to his ability to analyze and understand talent and identify talent at the quarterback position.
Ryan, you're up. Go ahead.
Yeah, you know, all well said, both of you. You know, unfortunate for him, obviously rooting for him. Local kid, Los Alamitos High School. I used to live right by there in Long Beach, so I knew Los Al really well. Him and obviously Makai Lemon were teammates. So, you know, I'm really rooting for him, and it's unfortunate that it didn't, you know, work out for him. That's you know, it's a good life lesson, right? Like that's perfectly life. I think the only two things I'll kind of add is, you know, one, it had to be a pretty big red flag for him in his camp. So he transferred, or he hit the transfer portal in like, I want to say it was like December 17th. I remember I was on vacation in New York. So it was right before Christmas. And then he committed to Boise shortly after that. Jaden Maiva transferred to SC like January 10th. And you remember Maiva transferred from UNLV from the Mountain West, the team that was in the championship that played Boise State. And if he's saying, I'd rather come to SC, compete, potentially be a backup, that was better for his development as a quarterback. And then you have Malachi Nelson saying, like, I don't want to do that. I'd rather go to the Mountain West, thinking that was better. That had to be somewhat of a, I don't know, of a red flag, but maybe his camp was like, oh, did we play this right? And the other piece of it, I'll just add, like, we know, we talked about this when it happened. There was a big NIL portion of this. You know, he was promised things back then and it didn't follow through. So that was, there was some competition things, but there was definitely an NIL play to this. And I think this also is a great learning point for him and other recruits and just other people in life to, you know, at that time, SC's NIL was not where it was today. They were still where it was still very new, working through things. And so regardless of what maybe he was promised or what didn't get, jumping that quickly and now knowing where the NIL is now, like I'm not saying he is, but maybe he's talking to guys now. I'm like, man, I would have waited out. Like I would have been taken care of. Like it wouldn't have been an issue. And then I got to compete and stayed there. So we don't know that a lot of that's speculation, but I think a lot of this story, unfortunately, just shows you that the grass isn't always greener and you got to wait things out. And you know, if he's in year three and this is still going on, that's one thing, but I mean, he was on campus for 8 months, right? Essentially. So, I mean, it's a very short time to make a life-changing decision to go to a much, let's just call it what it is, a much lesser football program, especially in developing quarterbacks. And then you don't win that job. It's definitely not a good look, but he has plenty of time, like Jamal said, plenty of time to turn things around. I'm rooting for him still. Absolutely. Always will. And then that's not just because he was committed to SC or from SoCal. All these kids I root for and want the best for them. And so hope he gets it right. But yeah, it's an unfortunate story and just shows a lot. It's a good learning tool, I think, for a lot of recruits and a lot of father specifically, when you're a father and you're on these visits and you got to look big picture and can't think snappily, snap decision, 8, 9, 10 months, you got to look 2, 3, 4 years into the future and see what's really right. And so I think that's a good lesson, maybe even more than for an 18-year-old kid, but for a father that's on these visits of saying like, okay, you know, things may not go our way year one, year two, maybe not even year three. But like we were just saying earlier, if Miller Moss goes on and wins the Heisman, what a tale of two stories between him and Malachi of what could be and what could have been.
Miller Moss has the opportunity to leave USC with a master's degree. He could walk down Figueroa as soon as the season's over. He could legit, and say they play on Monday and they lose. They play Monday at 8 a.m. and they lose that game. He could walk up the peristyle, walk down Figueroa, and walk into any of those buildings and say, you know what, my college career is open. I need a job. Like, it's over. I need a job. I have a bachelor's and a master's degree from the University of Southern California. Like, that's something you can't take away. The NCAA could take away your wins. The NCAA could take away your Heisman. NCAA has so much control over it. But what they can't take away is a bachelor's degree from USC and a master's degree from USC. That's one thing they can't take away. That's the big picture. Everybody's not going to make it. And it gets so hard. And I have these talks with people all the time. And maybe that's why I'm a little frustrated, because everybody wants you to make it. Like, you guys know, I have a soon-to-be 11-year-old. Well, is he playing football? No. Well, why not? He doesn't want to. He wants to play baseball and soccer. And then the 11-year-old comes and tells me, well, I want to be a pro baseball player like Shohei, because he made $700 million. So Shohei didn't just wake up and make $700 million. Shohei took 8,000 BP. Shohei pitched the ball. Shohei went through bullpen. Shohei did a whole bunch of sacrifices to be that good. And he had to work to get there. It's not just given to you. And I also just go back. I think he just has a really bad camp and he needs to change his camp. Like, and I feel so bad for the kid because it puts him in such a bad position to lose out. And I'm not saying nothing against Boise, but we all know a degree from SC is a little bit better than a degree from Boise. I mean, a degree from SC, I mean, it's better than a degree from anywhere, even the Ivy League. We all know that. Let's be real with ourselves. So I'm just saying, that's my big picture. And I know the big picture because I was in a part of it. And we still get caught with these kids who only want to go to the NFL. But what people don't understand, what people don't realize, when you don't make it in the real world, you get stuck in this void because you've been told your whole life you're going to the NFL and the NFL doesn't want you. And you get stuck with, what do I do now? Right? You're 24 years old, 23 years old. What do I do now? I don't know how to do anything else but play football. That's what we need to change. And that's where we need to get to points where he's like, well, I got this degree. I could go work at Goldman Sachs because I did financial advising. Let me go do that, which is a very competitive job. And you have to compete to hit your numbers or you'll get fired. Right. So like, we just need to prevent the void from these kids and like, all right, football didn't work out, but I could go do this. Let me go use my degree. And it's still just the same cycle, and it's so sick and it's so vicious. And the craziest part about it, it's not even racial. It happens with every single kid who plays at the Power Five level. You got anything else, Jamal?
Yeah, Coach. I mean, it's a great point. I mean, this is where it gets very, very hard, right? Where, you know, you talk about, I'll say two things. You talk about the camp of advisors and all this. You know, Miller Moss, you know, go look up Miller Moss's parents. You talk about, you know, sort of him being able to walk into Figueroa. Man, his dad owns half of Figueroa. Okay. So it's, you know, there's a different, I think, mindset there a little bit. Miller Moss kind of came from privilege. And I'm not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing, but I'm saying I think that sort of allowed him to perhaps be more patient than maybe other student athletes that maybe didn't come from that privilege, you know, so we have to sort of contextualize it a bit. And this is also where it gets very challenging, is when the NIL money is more than what, and Coach, we talked about this earlier in the summer, earlier in the offseason, when the NIL money is more than your expected value in the NFL, it's really hard to say no to the money. It's really hard not to chase the money. And this is where the fact that, to our earlier point, this isn't capped and the number of transfers is unlimited. This is where it's hurting the kids, right? Because you're always going to be going and chasing the bag. Life is a game of incentives, right? And right now, the incentive, the system right now is designed for the incentives to be in place where you go chase the biggest bag possible and you create suboptimal decisions for yourself in the long run, to your point, where what I'm going to maximize over the next 3 or 4 years may in the long run be detrimental to me. But it's very hard in that moment to not go chase the bag because A, it's so hard to make the NFL. The probability that you make a ton of money, look, outside of the Mahomeses and the Rodgers and the Herberts, I mean, outside of the 10 quarterbacks we all know, there's a very significant drop off. Like outside of 50 guys, it's really hard to make a lot of money in the NFL. And so, you know, you're incentivized to go chase the bag. And then, you know, you can always sort of self-rationalize where you're like, well, I can always kind of go back to school later and get the education and get the degree and set myself up. And so it's tough. I hear you 100%. And I think there's a lot of years of wisdom on this show of having kind of been around the block a few times. But this is where the system in place is very, very difficult to get these kids to kind of think clearly and make the right decisions. It's not their fault. And something's going to have to change in the long run because this just isn't sustainable.
The only thing I 1,000% agree.
We're going to end it on you, Ryan. We'll end it on you. Go ahead.
1,000% agree with everything you're saying, Jamal. So this is more just being cheeky and bringing it back to SC. So I totally agree with that. But the ironic thing is Lincoln Riley's been a head coach, what, 7 years, 8 years? He's coached 5 total quarterbacks if you include the one that transferred out, Spencer Rattler.
Yep.
Four of those fives are all starting quarterbacks. Yeah. And Spencer Rattler, by all indications, is challenging Derek Carr to start. Totally. So if there's any formula to get the bag, it is play quarterback for Lincoln Riley.
Totally.
I want to end on this. You've been watching a lot of Bluey saying cheeky, because that's definitely a Bluey comment right there, Ryan.
Bluey, and I work with two guys from England. So.
Yeah, oh, there you go. Yeah. That makes sense, definitely. Fellas, it's been good. Great conversation, man. It's always good to have good conversation. It's time to get the season started. It's time to get prepping. Let's get ready to go. I'll see you guys next time. Fans, I'll see you guys next time. Thank you guys for watching. You guys know how it is. It's the BetOnline Salute Detroit podcast. Now it goes. They're free. Fight on.